good now. I hope you are doing splendidly well. Thank you very much for tuning in and for joining me. This is going to be the first in a new periodic series that I'll be doing once a month, every other month, something like that, where I will be, I guess you would say, providing commentary on the different series of mangas. And let me explain for a moment before we get started. Obviously, I can't read verbatim from the books because of copyright issues. I can't flip through all the pages on camera because of copyright issues. I don't want to read from Wikipedia, and I don't want to give an overall review, and, you know, that would be somewhat of a short video, and there's plenty of reviews out there, and this isn't really about me providing my opinion, right? Because my opinion doesn't matter. So, what I will be doing, I guess, is what you might consider commentary. I'm going to, in this ASMR format, this relaxing, laid-back format where I'll be flipping through the pages of the books. There are three omnibus books for this particular manga. The Drifting Classroom. And just talking, giving you an idea of what's going on without actually reading verbatim from the books. And hopefully you'll find this to be relaxing. And this is the only way I could think of to kind of enjoy or share in the interest or pastime, hobby, however you want to call it, of reading manga. I just got into manga for the first time myself back around July 2020. I did a couple videos already about that, and I will link them in this video. You see the little pop out there. You can click on those if you like. So yeah, we're gonna give this a go, and this format might change from manga to manga, all depending upon the type of book and how large the series is. So, with that said, why don't we get started with book one of the, I guess, the omnibus book one that collects all the chapters. I guess part one of The Drifting Classroom by Kazuo Umezu. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. This came out back in the 1970s, around 1974, I believe. Okay. Oh, we have to tap on the cover of the book first. Plan on trying to spend 10 to 15 minutes on each book, and there are three of them in total, so hopefully I can get through each one in about 10 to 15 minutes. I don't want this video to be too long, but again, the nature of the ASMR format is to help you relax after all. Okay, so the book opens up with a little quote from our main protagonist, which I won't read. so you know, there will be spoilers in here. But, you know, maybe that won't bother you. And that was a bit of a foreboding quote, you might say. And then we have a glimpse into the everyday life of Sho, the main protagonist. Kind of an everyday, average kid. Little bit of a temper. He's young. About 10 years old, maybe. I think around that age. He's, one scene, he's at a playground playing with a little kid on a tricycle. He likes to play pranks on people. Always asking mom for money. Bringing home stray cats. So, a little bit of a temper. A little bit of a wild child, you might say. And then, one day, he's, I think, looking for something, and I think his mother, or at least he blames his mother for misplacing it, gets into an argument with his mother, and next thing we know, one morning on the way to school, he says, "I wish you weren't my mother." Slams the door on the way out, and then she yells to him, "I wish you weren't my child." And then, so he's off to school. He's kind of pissed off. Meets up with another kid on his way to school as well. The other kid realizes he forgot his lunch money and decides to go back and get it. And then on his way back to school, there's a loud boom. And, you know, they're all trying to figure out what was that loud sound. The one kid, you know, that went back to get his lunch money, he's trying to run to check it out. And he comes across the school sign laying on the ground. And then he, you know, picks it up. He's like, "What's this doing on the ground?" He looks up. And that's when, and I'll occasionally show some pictures from the books, but again, because of copyright, gotta be a little careful. So he looks up, and that's when we see school is no longer there. And then he kind of like just falls down in shock. We go back to Sho's home. That's the main protagonist. And his mother is kind of, you know, going through the after effects of the little argument she had with her son, cleaning things up. She looks out the window, knows there's a big commotion. So she decides to join everybody. They're like, "What's going on?" There was a big explosion near the school. They get down to the school, and all the parents realize the school's not there, so they're freaking out, wondering what's going on. And meanwhile, Sho gets to school. There's morning assembly. Nothing unusual, you know, happening, as far as they know. And then all of a sudden, they start to feel like a rattling. School feel like it's shaking. And then, you know, like, why is the classroom moving? And then they're all kind of in shock, all the kids. And all of a sudden, there's a boom. So this was just a few moments before the explosion. So there's a lot of rumbling going on and shuddering of the building. All the kids are scared. Some of them are getting under their desks. One of the teachers looks outside into the school grounds. Everything looks fine. You know, they're not really sure what's going on. And then the next thing they know, some of the students look out and happen to notice one of the other teachers stumbling onto the school grounds. So one of the other teachers rush out to see what's going on. And then they notice there's a bunch of teachers just standing at the main gate, just looking out. Some of the teachers, including Sho, or I should say some of the other students, decide to join them. And they look out, and they see a bit of a wasteland, you might say. So I forgot to kind of mention that this is somewhat of a post-apocalyptic sci-fi kind of story. Alright, so that was kind of the introduction, I guess, chapter one, the shuddering classroom. And so there everybody's like looking, you know, what happened, what's going on, where's the houses, it's all just sand and rocks. And then we move on to chapter two, Frightened Eyes. So they're all students. Sho, I guess, is running back to tell the kids there is nothing out there but desert. Now everybody's like, you know, take a look from the hallway. You can look out the windows. You can see it's all just post-apocalyptic wasteland. And, you know, this can't be real. They're all kind of questioning everything. They run out, some of the students run out onto the roof of the building, and you get a much bigger glimpse of the entire landscape, which is really cool. One of the students decides to, and I want to briefly just point out all the multitude of violent deaths that happened to the kids in this series, and I have to laugh because I'm from the United States, and here in the U.S., everyone is uptight about violence, especially when it comes to violence with kids. Everything's got to be, you know, like perfect. No one ever dies. No, cartoons are safe, and everybody's happy and all this. I don't think a book like this would have ever gotten published in the United States in the 70s, let alone today. I mean, I just, and speaking from my own personal experience, having lived here in the United States, I've never seen any kind of comic book where kids get killed in them. And so this was kind of not shocking, like, oh my gosh, I can't deal with it, but just kind of shocking to see, based on my own experience with everything happened in the United States, a lot of, besides movies, and even in movies you can't show kids getting killed, but, and it's not that I like to see kids getting killed, you know, don't take them the wrong way, but this is, it just speaks to the how free the people in Japan are when it comes to their art. In manga especially, anything goes. And they're brave and they're bold and they take risks. And it's great. I love it. So, anyway. So one of the kids decides to jump off the roof, you know, screaming, "I want my mommy." And you see her smack, fall to the ground. They don't have, there's not a lot of gore. I mean, there is, you know, some scenes with blood, but it's all black and white. But there's not like a lot of guts spilling out. So all the kids are freaking out, and all the teachers are trying to, kids want to go outside of the school grounds. Teachers aren't letting them. When the teacher smacks the kids to try to get them to calm down, and they're all screaming for their mom, and we have our main character Sho, you know, trying to hold back the tears. Here's just another little glimpse. Love this style too. It's an old kind of a style of art. It's reminiscent reminiscent of like the 50s and the 60s, I guess the 70s as well. So everybody's freaking out. You know, kids are freaking out, teachers don't know what's going on. A whole bunch of the kids start to make a mob of kids trying to make it to the front gate, and they knock down one of the female teachers. You can even the scene of one of the kids' shoes kicking the teacher in the chin as she's on the ground, blood spattering out. One of the other teachers grabs another student. He breaks his glasses to turn them into a sharp object, and he says if anybody else, you know, if they don't calm down, he's going to stab this kid. Well, he actually stabs the kid in his arm. And it's, you know, quite bloody in a black and white kind of way. And then you find out he actually stabbed his own son. So they're all just in a panic, you know, trying to figure out what's going on. And Sho, again, the main protagonist, decides to use the phone and call home. And finds out the phones aren't working. So he's screaming, "Mom, Mom," hangs up the phone. He's in like the TV, he's in the teacher's lounge, I guess. Turns the TV on, TV's not working. All the other teachers show up, and they notice this. They find a radio, turn on the radio, that's not working either. So one of the other teachers starts it, you know. Female teachers has a little bit of a fit. She kind of faints, she can't take it, she falls on the ground. They think it's all, radioactive wasteland or something. One of the other teachers comes back. It's actually the principal. He's all bleeding from the forehead, saying that he was attacked. Apparently someone tried to rob all the teachers' paychecks. And so the principal decides to, you know, follow the tracks, and he finds a trail of blood from where the robbers broke in some glass window, cut themselves on, and he sees the trail leading out of the school grounds to a wall. He looks over the wall, he peers out, and that's the first time the principal sees the wasteland himself. He kind of faints right there. So, they're all trying to, you know, get some order. So one of the teachers tells the one student, Sho, to go back and to tell everyone that he was able to get, you know, in contact with his parents, and the parents are still alive. And some of the kids don't believe that, think he's a liar, right? So all the other teachers try to get up there and try to, you know, try to get the kids to calm down, trying to come up with, you know, hey, you know, we don't know what's going on, but your parents are still alive. So all the kids are like, yay. So students from one class tied up one of their teachers, and one of the kids, I think from that class, decides to run out the main gate. So he's running out. He's like screaming back, you know, to other kids who are like, come back. And he's like, I'm going home. And the next thing you know, he runs out there and he falls down and don't really sure what's going on. And then one of the other teachers shows up, closes the gate, says, you know, no one's going out there. And meanwhile, the kid that ran out there is still laying on the ground on the wasteland. So still trying to figure out what's going on. And then they're talking about the food, you know, what about the food? So they go into the lunchroom, and one of the kids sees a piece of bread on the floor, and the lunchroom man slams a pole out of the end of a mop or something onto the kid's hand. He's grinding it into his hand. And the lunchroom man, yeah, he's using a mop, smacks Sho with the mop. And he's like, listen up, this food is mine. So he has become like the, he's kind of lost his mind. So all the kids are like, all right, what do we do now? This guy's got all the food. How are we gonna eat? So they tell one of the teachers. And so the teacher's like, all right, stay here. You know, we'll go try to figure out what's going on. Meanwhile, lunchroom man has a couple of the teachers and a student tied up. And there's other students and teachers gathering outside the lunchroom cafeteria. So he decides to set them all on fire, stop them. And so he pours a bunch of oil outside the door, sets it on fire. A couple of teachers get caught on fire. And it's just kind of crazy. I mean, it's a horror manga after all. So I'm just still getting used to seeing this kind of stuff in a something you would consider a comic book. But so one of the other teachers comes back using the fire, uses a fire extinguisher, puts the fire out. Mother's trying to figure out, you know, what to do about all the food that the lunchroom man has. One of the kids finds a gun. I guess one of the other teachers dropped a gun, I'm not sure. So he's like, all right, I'm going to go in there and teach lunchroom man, you know, a thing or two. So he goes in there with the gun. He doesn't see the lunchroom man. And this is when one of the first kind of gruesome, brutal death occurs to one of the students. His lunchroom man ends up coming up behind the kid and stabbing him in the back with a knife. And the kid ends up trying to turn and shoot his gun at lunchroom man, but he misses and shoots one of the other students. Some more blood. So that's like three students killed so far. So there's mayhem now, the chaos and mayhem, and the lunchroom man picks up the gun. And Sho, our hero, was able to get some bread and a drink. So he goes off to do something else. He notices the kid on the tricycle that he saw, I think, the other day in the beginning of the book at the playground. And the kid is dragging a sign, school sign, behind his tricycle. And that brings us to chapter 5, The Challenge of 6th Grade Class 3. And sorry if I didn't mention that. A couple other previous chapter titles. So he notices the school sign. It's all damaged. He brings it back to the front of the school where it fits perfectly. And then he kind of has this memory of, I think, this other book or something, how two planes, one from the current era, and then one from from years ago, almost collided in midair. It was a Cessna and a biplane, and when the Cessna pilot turned around after the close call, almost the midair impact, the biplane was gone. So that kind of put some thought into Sho's head as to what's going on. So then he tries to figure out where it was buried. And it was in a sandbox or something, or the little kid didn't want to tell him because he was hungry. So they gave him some food, and Sho starts to think of what actually happened to them. And meanwhile, another kid shows up. He's all battered and bruised on his face, and he says, Sakia, I think that's the lunchroom teacher's name, did this to me. And I think the lunchroom teacher is going around the different classes trying to get everybody's food. So he's brandishing a knife and a gun, and he actually slashes, in one scene, like five different kids. And some of them are bent over, bleeding out from their chest or whatever. And he's just talking about how he's gonna be, the boss, and we're going to wait. He's going to hold on to the food, and they're, you know, the United States or whoever is going to rescue everybody pretty soon. So now he's going from classroom to classroom, trying to figure out, you know, who stole bread from him or whatever, and trying to get everybody's food. So they're trying to deal with that. And so he breaks in one of the rooms. The kids jump him. He ends up trying to shoot one of the kids, but he misses. Kind of does graze the side of the face of one of the kids. Sho ends up punching him in the face, and then eventually they are able to subdue and knock down Sakia, I think, the lunchroom teacher. They tie him up, and they end up putting him in a locker. So pretty crazy and intense. If you've read it, you know what I'm talking about. So, and now they're, you know, back to trying to figure out what to do. They notice a solar eclipse. And then they finally get back around to trying to find out where that kid on his tricycle found the school sign. He takes them out into the wasteland, and they find a sign that says, here lie the souls of the 862 people of Yamato Elementary School. Which is, you know, kind of think about, think about it, and sounds like something that was written, you know, based on the fact that the students of the school, you know, something happened to them. So shows everybody, and he's like, see, we really did come to the future. So they go back. So he's kind of screaming out, mom, dad, out in the middle of the desert. So they decide to go back to school. Meanwhile, some of the teachers are gathered together, and, you know, one of them, I think the principal, he's like, this is insane, I can't take it anymore. One of the other teachers slashes his throat right there. One of the other teachers is like, you know, gotta tie me down, I don't think I'm gonna control myself. And he's like hunched over near a tree. One of the other teachers comes to try to help him. And the guy that was, you know, saying he might not be able to control himself ends up strangling the teacher that tries to help him. Another one shows, another teacher shows up, like, what's going on? The teacher that lost, you know, just choked the other teacher, takes his belt, strangles that new teacher that just showed up to see what was going on. So he basically killed all the other teachers. Shows up, you know, from running back out from the desert. He doesn't know what's really going on. The teacher lies to him and says, you know, all these other teachers have killed themselves. And then meanwhile, the lunchroom man in the locker, he kind of saw everything, and he's like, that teacher, he just killed everybody. Of course, they're not going to listen to lunchroom man because of what he tried to do. So then they bury one of the kids, and they're trying to still figure out what's going on. They get into a car, a teacher's car, and they drive out into the wasteland to see how far they can go or whatever. And that's when they also come upon this other girl who has a bit of a limp. She walks around with a crutch. They come upon another kid who's got like a bag around his face. And that's, and he tells them the teacher that's driving the car did this to him. So now they find out about the truth about this last teacher. And he just loses it. He gets back in the car and decides to try to run over all the kids. And he ends up running over and hitting one of them. You actually see the car kind of run over the kid. Another kid gets hit, I think. So they're trying to run away. And yeah, another kid gets hit onto the windshield. And for a couple scenes, the kid's on the hood of the car. It's funny in a way. Another kid gets run over again. He's face down into the desert, and you can see the car. car just running over his back. And the other kid still on the hood of the car. So Sho, the hero, he's trying to help the girl with the crutches. She throws her crutch at the car, smashes through the window, almost hits the guy. She kind of almost gets hit. They end up into a tunnel. They're walking down into the tunnel further and further. And that's when they come upon this big scene of them being in some kind of old skyscraper. And then the man, the teacher, got out of his car, comes down in the tunnel. Now he's trying to choke Sho. And Sho is there with the girl with the crutches. And he's, you know, basically just trapped. He's going to get killed. And he's getting choked. And he's like screaming out, "Mom, Mom." Then we flash back into present time. Back in, I think they're in Japan. They have a barbed wire. They erected a barbed wire around the school. And so Sho's mom, she's freaking out. You know, she's trying to figure out what to do. She doesn't want to eat. And then there are some news reports about what happened with, including the one kid that went back to get his lunch money, who, you know, ended up going back to school, but the school disappearing before he went in. And the mom's like, why did he get to be saved and not my son? And next thing, the phone rings, mom answers it, and she hears Sho's voice calling to her from future Sho, you know, but they're not really, they're in two different timelines, but it's kind of going on at the same time, I think you might say. So she's like, "Sho, how is this, you know, is this you? How do I know it's you and all this?" And, you know, dad kind of thinks, you know, what's going on? She's having some kind of, you know, his wife must be crazy, whatever. So she runs out. She ends up falling down outside the street. And, you know, and she hears a voice again, trying to get some sleep. So she wakes up. She's in her gown. She's running out into the street in like 2 o'clock in the morning, freaking out, you know, "Sho, Sho, where are you?" She gets into a taxi. She tells the taxi, just keep driving. She hears the voice getting a little bit louder. She ends up at a hotel. She goes up to the hotel where she thinks the voice is coming from. She knocks on some stranger's door in one of the hotel rooms. She bursts in after he answers the door. He's like, "Sho, Sho, where are you?" And they're like, "What the hell are you doing in that room?" She's yelling, pounding on the window, you know, "Sho, where are you?" So finally the husband comes back, takes her back home. And she goes to Sho's room, and she's like, she has a feeling that Sho might need this, and she grabs a knife that he had. I don't know how he got a hold of the knife or whatever, but so she changes her appearance, goes back to the hotel, gets back into that room after the, you know, the other couple has left, and she starts to drill a hole into the wall. And then she gets some help from, I think from the kid who went back to get his lunchroom or his lunch money and didn't end up disappearing. She gets him to keep lookout while she drills a hole into the wall, one of the walls of the hotel room, and patch it up. And then she's like, "Sho, I hope you find this wherever you are." And Sho ends up reaching into the rubble of the future hotel, finds a knife, stabs a teacher in the neck, and he falls out of the window to his death. And now he's like, "This is my knife," and all this. You know, like, how did this happen? I don't know. But somehow he was able to, you know, get in contact with his mom. They run back to school, him and the girl with the crutches. They find a kid up on a crucifix. And now we are on to chapter 10, Sacrifice. And it's been a wild ride so far, you know, for me to sit here and say I love it. I mean, I can say that about all the manga titles I've read. I haven't really been disappointed at all. Of course, I love almost all kinds of art. You know, movies, comedies, horror films, dramas, independent films, Netflix shows, documentaries, music, you name it. Not that I'm like, oh, I'm some great guy or anything, but, you know, I can appreciate all kinds of art, that's all. So anyway, I know this video is going to be a little bit longer than I had planned. Hopefully, still find this to be relaxing, and especially if you enjoyed this particular manga yourself. Alright, so Sho ends up back at school, and they find one of the kids up on a cross. They're getting ready to burn him alive. And this is somewhat like Lord of the Flies. I've never read that book or seen the movie. I think there was a movie based on it. But they start to set the kid on fire, and he's actually close to getting burned alive. And all these younger kids, I don't know if they're first and second graders or something like that, have decided to kill anyone that they think might be involved. And it's kids whose last names or first names start with T.A. or something like that. So the flames are going up, and Sho runs to get with a bucket of water, finds there's a pool, a school pool. He runs back with the water, putting the fire out, tells all the kids, and they're all saved. Hey, we have water now. So they're all kind of happy about that. Now that all the teachers are dead, Sho decides to step up and take charge, trying to tell the kids what happened and that they need to try to just keep going and make sense of what's going on. So then he gets another little kid genius to think that while their parents are not, and the outside world is not outside the school anymore, that the parents are still alive in another timeline, so to speak, but they don't say timeline. Right, so, and then that chapter ends with a rattle at the front of the school gates. Brings us to chapter 11, One Leaf from a Tree. Oh, and I did mention they did find a leaf out, a plant out in the wasteland on the earlier chapters, but it was plastic. All right, so they go to see what was going on out front, and there was a kid at the front gate. He comes back with the leaf from an actual plant. So now they think, all right, we're doing, this is great. Now there's food out there or something. They were going to send an exploratory party to go exploring to find out, you know, where the plant came from. And meanwhile, the teacher locked in the locker lies to another kid passing by. There's a wire on the ground. He's like, hey, I need that wire. I got a bad tooth. If the kid gives him a wire, he's able to get himself out of the locker, and he grabs the kid, and the kid has a bowl of ramen, and the teacher smashes the bowl of ramen in the kid's face and says, as if I would eat this shitty ramen. It's brutal. Then he kicks the kid in the face, knocks the kid down, and now he's back with a knife. He grabs the kid, little boy, with the tricycle, who doesn't even belong at that school. And now he's like, you know, you're going to do as I say. And he finds out about the search party. So they go out to find where the little leaf came from. They find this little area with all this weird vegetation. And they find something that looks like a fruit. Crazy teacher, crazy lunchroom man tries to force one Sho to eat one of the fruit. You know, he spits it. He does, and he spits it out. And then a teacher does the same thing. Just turns to sand when they eat it. And then they hear a rustling in the vegetation. You know, they're not sure what it is. And they find out that there's this giant centipede-like creature. And they decide to... Crazy lunchroom guy throws his knife at it, trying to, I guess, kill it or something. And then it turns around and focuses on them and starts coming after them. So they're all running away. Lunchroom man throws one of the other kids into the path, try to slow down the creature. It runs over the kid. I'm not sure if it ate him or not. So they're all trying to run back to school. Teacher is really just thinking about himself. Knocks over some of the other kids. Centipede rises up just about to eat the teacher. Meanwhile, Sho is carrying the little, 4-year-old kid on his back who doesn't belong at that school. They're trying to get back to school. A bunch of other kids are attack some of the other ones out of fear. So these two kids, they are the first to run away and go back to school. And then meanwhile, one of the other kids, says we have to fight. He jumps on top of the centipede, grabbing at its antennae. Centipede kind of flicks the kid up in the air, and then just catches him. It does one of these, like an outfielder would do, trying to catch a ball with his glove. And he catches the kid in his mouth, and the centipede creature just starts chomping at him. So meanwhile, the other kids go back, and the two kids that kind of knocked down some other kids and got back to school first said no one else made it back. Now we're on to chapter 12, new leader, the queen. So meanwhile, at the school, there's these older kids. I don't know if they're in eighth grade or something like that. I forget. I don't think there's any high school. I think it's just elementary. So these three tough girls show up, talking about how they're going to be in charge now, and they start beating on one of the other girls. They grab one of the boys, who's kind of speaking out, and they start to humiliate him by taking off his clothes, attacking him. And they get him completely undressed, and then they get him down on the floor. And then one of the most brutal scenes I've ever seen in a comic book or a manga, one of these older girls pretty much grinds her foot down onto the young boy's genital area. And you see that. You just see her foot. They don't show the genitals, but you see her foot over them, and you just see a big grind, action, text, and he's screaming out in pain, and, I've never seen anything like that. It's just crazy. I'm not saying it's bad or, good to see that. I'm just saying, it's kind of cool to see, just in the fact that you don't normally see something like that. So, all the girls are like, so this is what we'll do to you if you, speak out, whatever. So, now they're trying to assert their dominance, beating on some other girl. And there's something going on with a missing shoe. I forget what that's about. And then Sho ends up returning back to school. And they're like, wow, you're back. And the other two kids, who got back first, they said that Sho and the others were dead, but now, they're caught that, what they did, they left them to die, and that lunchroom guy also made it back. But he comes back acting all like, as if, he went into some shock. He's acting like a little baby. He's saying goo goo gaga and all this. Now he's come back and with these, confronts the female, the queen and her gang. They get into a fight with Sho, and then she finds the kid who had the missing shoe. I forget what the missing shoe was involved. It's not too much of a big deal, but it is actually his shoe. It wasn't, I think someone else stole the shoe or something, I don't know. They're about to break his finger. Then they realize there's a whole bunch of kids up on the roof screaming out for the moms and dads, first graders, I think. Chapter 13, The Formation of the Yamato Elementary School Nation. Yamato, which is kind of funny. It's the name of the Star Blazers battleship. Battleship Yamato, right? So all these kids are up on the roof, fenced roof, screaming out, Mom, Dad, and one of the kids decides to, he says, I'm gonna fly like a bird. He jumps off, climbs up the fence, jumps over, and splat, he lands, you know, falls down on the ground. And that's, you see him face first on the ground, and they have that big action text that says, splat. So, Show, the hero of the story, he's like, no, don't do it, don't do it. Three other kids decide to jump, and they all land down, and they're laying on the ground. Show tries to help them, but he really can't do much. So he lifts up one of the kids. He's, you know, his face is crushed and everything, showing the kids on the roof, this is what happens if you do this, stop it, you know, all that. So, meanwhile, you know, there's the whole standoff between Show and the students and the queen. So they decide to have a vote of who should rule, who should be in charge of the school. And they all vote for Show. And there was one tiebreaker, but he voted for Show. So the queen and her little couple of friends decide to leave, and all the kids are back trying to, you know, figure out what to do next. And they come up with this other kid, comes up, and he's like, has this voracious appetite. He just can't stop eating. So, you know, he's trying to eat all the food. And, you know, of course, it's psychological, I guess, out of fear and everything. So they're trying to figure out what to do with him. Meanwhile, they're talking about that big, giant insect. So they start coming up with a plan to make some traps in case it comes back. And that brings us to chapter 14, Incoming Giant Insect. So they have all their traps in place. And I think the kid that was really hungry, actually towards the end of chapter 13, sorry. That kid that was really hungry, you know, he got caught eating again. He's running away, doesn't want to get in trouble, and gets caught in the trap, one of the traps they just made, and it slams down on him. It almost got Sho as well, but he's off to the side. And meanwhile, this big giant contraption with wooden spikes slammed down on the other kid and killed him. Meanwhile, the giant centipede bug decides to come to the school. So it's coming across the landscape, and they can see it coming. So all the kids are like, you know, get inside. It comes to the first trap that was already sprung and crushed the other kid. It climbs over it. So the kids have built a little catapult, wooden catapult. They launch it at the centipede. It goes into its mouth, but then it just eats the big wood arrow made out of a tree or something, I forget. So now they're all freaking out. They throw a bottle of hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, reach at the giant centipede. Doesn't do anything. So they're all running back into school, trying to figure out what to do, closing all the doors. Centipede is just bashing through all the doors, coming after everybody. Catches one of the kids in its claws, actually snaps off his hand. And you see his hand, the kid was trying to attack the centipede with an axe. And in one of the scenes here, you see the kid's hand falling off with a little bit of a blood trail. And the axe handle split in half as well. And he's laying on the ground like, my arm. He's bleeding out from his one arm. And he's like, I can still fight. So kid's got brave, to say the least. So they're trying to throw spears or whatever at the monster. The kid that had his arm snapped off, he, you know, charges at the creature. And he's like, yeah. And the last thing you hear is crack and screaming out. And they're all freaking out, you know, what to do. And, you know, we have chloroform, we have these other bottles or whatever. And then they figure out that maybe, I forget, but they're trying to get all the, they think that the creature is attracted to thought. When everybody, you know, just the people, you know, being awake and active minds or whatever. So they're trying to get all the kids to go to sleep and not think about anything. So they're using chloroform on some of the kids, the younger kids, just to make them go to sleep. And now they're all trying to focus on something like a chair. Sho says, everybody become a chair, just focus on a chair. So they do that, and the giant centipede Sho is in the hallway, just crouched down, just thinking nothing of but being a chair. Centipede walks right past, or skitters right past. Meanwhile, all the other kids are doing the same thing, except for one kid who starts freaking out, and two other kids. Another kid kind of reacts, and the centipede gets a hold of them, snaps off one of the kids' heads, and you see the head thunk onto the desk, and then it falls off on the ground in front of some of the other kids who are ducked down on their desk. But by that time, the giant centipede thing goes out the window, scurries away. And then Sho goes back to one of the other kids, and there's like dismembered legs on the floor, and the one kid who lost his arm, he's kind of, you know, he's kind of crying there and upset about that and everything. And they found out the bug got all their food and supplies as well. So that brings us to chapter 15, A Desperate Challenge. So they all decide to go hunt the bug down. They get a bunch of axe blades made out of stone, attached to some wooden handles with ropes tied to the handles so that they could throw these, you know, homemade axes at the centipede crab thing and then pull the axes back with their ropes. And that is the final part of that chapter. End of volume, Omnibus Volume 1, which takes us to almost 1 hour long already, and we still have two more volumes, so I'll try to be a little bit more quicker. I didn't want this video, I thought I could do this in like 45 minutes, 50 minutes, but I think it's going to take me close to 2 hours. I'll try to go through here a little more quickly as possible. All right, so we are on Omnibus Omnibus 2, starting with chapter, I guess chapter 22, Creeping Shadow of Death. Alright, so we have all the students with their axes going out to the vegetation where they first encountered giant, the bug. And then they come across a drawing from some kid that drew the bug. And I'm like, how did you even know about that? You know, the bug. Now, it was drawn before all the events happen. They also have the teacher with them. And the bug eventually shows up, comes out of the sand, rises up out of the sand. And, you know, they're all trying to, some of them are scared, but they all start throwing their homemade axes at the thing, just bouncing off its hard exoskeleton, but they do get it tied up a little bit. Although it starts to unsnap everything. And then they realize, come to realization that maybe the monster is coming from this kid's imagination. This one kid, because he drew the monster before it even ever appeared. So they want the kid to stop thinking about that giant centipede monster. And for whatever reason, the crazy lunchroom guy takes a hold of that kid, starts to run away with him. And, you know, they knock him down. They get a hold of the kid, and they're trying to tell him, stop thinking about the centipede creature, you know. And, you know, so Sho gets the idea that he'll just, you know, stab the kid and kill him. And that's the only way they're going to be able to stop. So he goes up to the kid, and there's a scene of Sho stabbing the kid with the knife, just as a centipede creature is on top of both of them. And then all of a sudden, centipede creature is about to chomp down on both Sho and the other kid, but it ends up becoming sand, disappearing. Meanwhile, you find out that Sho didn't actually kill the kid. He just faked him out. At the last minute, he turned the knife blade around and just, you know, punched the kid in the chest with the hilt of the blade. So then they find all their food that was, I guess, you know, taken by the centipede monster. And now they go back to school, and they start to see this one kid has holes all over his body, small holes. So they get back to school, and they don't see any of the kids around. They open up one door, and a skeleton falls out. And then you hear a bunch of screaming and everything. Going to see what's going on. They go down the stairs of one room, or one part of the school. There's all these thousands, millions of these tiny little bugs crawling up and eating the kids alive. They eat them so fast they turn right into bones. Happens right before their eyes. Just to give you a little glimpse of that. So they're, you know, freaking out, trying to figure out what to do. Sho smashes one of the little bugs with his axe and find out it's actually a small version of the giant centipede. So they're back at it again with that, thinking it's that one kid again who keeps, you know, having this active imagination, keeps bringing all these monsters to life. So this other kid thinks that it's actually Sho's fault. So they run to the main gate, trying to escape, but all the little centipede creatures are all over the gate. So, and now they're coming in a big swarm, just consuming anything that they touch. So all the kids are trying to run away and get away from that. They get a hold of that kid again, who thought about the giant centipede in the first place, telling him it's his fault. He's like, fine, you know. And then he just ends up smashing his own forehead in with one of the stone axes and killing himself. And then with that, I believe pretty much the little centipede bugs stopped and disappeared. Sho confronts this other kid, who is kind of now another antagonist, and has kind of started all this mob violence to hunt down that kid who was thinking of the centipede bugs. And Sho's like, you know, we gotta join together. So they go back to school, and brings us to chapter 18, Deadly Thirst. So now they're talking about the food and the water in the pool, and they find one of the kids that jumped into the pool. They drag him out, and they find out he has spots all over him. So now they start start to think that the kid has a plague, his liver is failing, and that he might have contaminated the water in the pool. If he does have plague, you know, who else was in contact with the kid? You know, because they might get plague too. They think it might be the bubonic plague. So there's that going on. And, you know, they're talking about, you know, the impact of that. Meanwhile, this kid gets out, crawling down the hallway. Some other kids stumble on him. I don't think they know what's going on or whatever. So, they try to clean him and get him back into the bed, into the infirmary. And meanwhile, there's a side little conversation about some of the trees that they planted at the school starting to bear fruit, and how, you know, that's not going to last long because there's no insects to pollinate the trees. So whatever grows will be the last time that, you know, the last thing that they have to eat. One of the girls decides to go back to check in on the kid, possibly has plague. They find out that somehow he was turned around in the bed. His head was facing the one way, then they notice that his legs are now facing that way. Brings us to chapter 19, Black Spots. And this has got a lot going on. I mean, when I first, you know, picked up the first omnibus in this series, I really wasn't quite sure what I was getting myself into. I didn't do any research into it or anything. I noticed it got a decent amount of good reviews, so I gave it a shot. And as soon as I finished the first volume, I just had to pick up number 2 and number 3. Absolutely love everything that happens and transpires. It's great. Alright, so they're all still freaking out about the kid with the plague. Some of the other kids are getting angry about it, what to do about it, who might be infected, you know, whose fault it might be. Sho and a bunch of the other kids who found the kid that might have the plague, you know, he's kind of like telling everybody to stay away from him and these other kids because they might have it too, but they need to wait a whole day or so to see if it actually, you know, if they actually come down with the plague. So they go out into the wasteland to, you know, try to come up with a plan. Maybe they can get the kid in the infirmary outside as well. But then they notice there's fire and smoke, and it looks like someone might have tried to set the infirmary on fire. Sho goes back. Meanwhile, the kids that might have the bubonic plague are still out in the desert. But Sho goes back to try to help. And they're like, oh, we have a problem. It seems like the other kids, it seems like there might be something else that might have contact with that kid that has the plague. Because they noticed that he was facing a different direction in the bed in the infirmary. So they come, they find out, they stumble upon that kid's soiled pants in the desert. They clean them up, and they find footprints. They see one of the kids, one of the other kids, tripped and fell, and they can see a little pin print from a pin that he's wearing on his clothes. So they're trying to trace, you know, who these other kids are that came in contact with that kid with a bubonic plague. They come back and they see these other kids holding all these spears. And they don't want, you know, they're trying to hunt down, I guess, whoever might have the plague. I forget exactly, but they end up stabbing this other kid who was with Sho. Stab him right in the gut. And now they're kind of turning on Sho, saying it's all his fault, and they're coming after him. They're chasing them all down into the desert. And just when it looks like they're about to spear show in the stomach, he was actually able to evade that. And they keep running and running. And they come down to, they find some medicine in bottles, but it crumbles to dust. Sho finds a cave, and he finds a vault in a cave. He opens it up, finds a body, and like a body of a person. And the head kind of rears up as they all come in to take a look. And they find out that, you know, when corpses, I guess in dry environments, get exposed to outside air and moisture, cause the movement among the body parts or whatever. So then they, whatever reason, they take out the mummy, the corpse, bring it outside. And it's been about a day since they were in contact with that kid with that bubonic plague, and they're not infected. They have no fever or anything. So they think they're okay. All right, so now there's a ruckus at the school, some kind of noise. So they decide to run back and see what's going on. And that brings us to chapter 21, Endless Rampage. So they go back to school. They find out that little toddler with the tricycle from the very beginning of the book that Sho was playing with in the playground is being held captive by these other kids. So these other kids are on a witch hunt, so to speak, including this one kid who's somewhat of a rival of Sho's. So I guess they're trying to round up anyone who might been involved with the plague. And so some of the kids that were in contact with the plague kid who moved them, now they have spots on them. And you know, they're like, I don't want to die, and more fights breaking out among all the kids. And now some of the other kids are throwing torches at the part of the school, I guess the infirmary again, or another section, where some of the other kids are trapped. It's all boarded up, trying to set it on fire. Sho's trying to save everyone, and all the kids that are trapped inside this one room, they start throwing the kids on the outside that were, you know, trying to set the place on fire, now throwing rocks and spears inside. So that brings us to chapter 22, Creeping Shadow of Death. So all the kids inside, they're trying to do something, get away from the fire. There's nowhere to really go. So kids inside are trying to throw spears and rocks back down to the kids outside. So there's more violence going back and forth there. Some of the kids that are out in the desert notice the smoke and everything. And so they think up an idea. Maybe they can use the mummy that they found as a way to scare the kids and stop what's going on. So they get mummified corpse to stand up, and they push it towards the school, crouching down behind its legs. And that kind of causes the other kids, you know, causing all the trouble, to stop and to run in fear, thinking there's another monster coming. So Sho is able to rescue the toddler and the girl with the crutch, and put out the fire. And then the leader of the other group, he's come down with the plague. He's got spots on him. And so now they're trying to figure out, you know, they're still reacting to the fact that they might now all have the plague. And show once again starts calling out for his mother. Answer me, help me, and everything. And then we jump to chapter 23, separated time. We're back in the present. Show's mom, or the other present, the other reality, I should say. They now made a memorial to all the kids, but she starts freaking out, and there's flowers on the memorial, and, you know, she's knocks the flowers off and making a big commotion because she knows her son is still alive and that the memorial is a little too premature. So she gets all upset, gets into a fight. She goes back home trying to, just more turmoil with her. And she turns the TV on, and that's when she hears Sho's voice again. And I think she mentions, he says, you know, they need medicine. And she's like, how do I get medicine? And he's yelling out, you know, mommy, there's a body with a scar on the wrist, a mummified body. If you can put medicine inside of it, I'll get it somehow. And she's like, what? What body, what mommy, whatever. So now she's on another mission to find out whatever this this mummy is and this medicine that she needs to get. So she goes to a pharmacy, tries to get a hold of streptomycin or whatever it is, and they're all out, and she's freaking out. And she ends up going to a hospital, trying to get into the morgue. She ends up in the morgue, trying to find a body in the morgue that has this scar on its wrist. She doesn't see one on her way out. She sees a person that has a scar on their wrist. He was picking up some meds. So she goes after him. Hey, do you have a scar on your wrist? I need to see. He's like, who are you? Like, you're rude. You know, go away. You're crazy. So she's chasing after him. He gets away. Then a little kid, I think that helped her previously, keep lookout at the hotel. I think it's the same one. Tells her that, hey, didn't you know that's a famous baseball player? So they end up going to one of the games. And she jumps down onto the field. And he's trying to, he hits a ball to outfield or whatever. And he's trying to, you know, run home and, you know, score a home run. And she runs onto the field and tries to stop him. And her interruption causes him to get out, tagged out. And a lot of the people from the stands, they jump the wall. They come after her. They're trying to grab her. And, you know, because she caused one of the, causing a commotion and disrupted the game. And you know how rowdy sports fans can get. You know, she's trying to, there's a whole riot breaks out onto the baseball field. And meanwhile, she's trying to get a hold of the baseball player and tell him that, you know, he's going to end up becoming a corpse. And she's trying to figure out, you know, what to do and how he's involved. And he ends up taking a header at plate. He gets hit, tries to dodge a pitch, but he takes the pitch right to his forehead. He ends up going to the hospital. She ends up going to his room. She needs to go to the hospital where he is because she thinks he's going to die and become the corpse that she needs to put medicine in somehow. So she cuts her own wrist on the top part so she can go to the hospital. So she ends up going to the hospital and then ends up being admitted, ends up going and telling one of the nurses that that baseball player is going to become a mummy. They're laughing at her, you know, all this. Everybody thinks she's crazy, right? She's the only one that can hear Sho's voice. So she goes to the baseball player's room, and, you know, she's telling him that he's going to become a mummy, and then he's telling her that he might, you know, call it quits. The next thing you know, there's somebody shouting, there's a kidnapper, someone stole a child. They look out the window and they see the culprit. So the baseball player, He decides to go after the guy with the child. He ends up, you know, he grabs the child, but he ends up getting stabbed by the guy. And he ends up dying that way. So she sneaks down into the morgue, was able to get a hold of some medicine, cuts open the guy's stomach, slides the package of medicine into the corpse, the baseball player's stomach, sutures it back up, and then she just leaves the hospital. In future show, he ends up opening up the corpse's stomach and finds the medicine. So they go back to the school. They have the medicine. I think they start to give everybody the medicine, and they find out there was a squirrel carrying the bubonic plague. So they end up killing a squirrel, which is exactly what happened in present time. I think at the same time, I might have not mentioned it, but they found there was a report of a squirrel carrying the bubonic plague in Japan in present time. Or that gets mentioned later, I forget which. And there is actually a scene of the kids crying over the fact that they had to kill a squirrel. Or maybe it's just a combination of all the things that they've been going through, welling up. All right, so that brings us to chapter 24, Lost Hope. And now we have a show trying to tell all the kids that they need to start planting seeds and cultivating and growing a garden. They go back and find out that all the water in the pool is now gone because of cracks in the bottom of the pool. And so now Sho is trying to organize a bunch of kids to go out and search for a source of water. And they do that, and they find some footprints out in the desert made by a kid or somebody. It looks like they stretch for miles. Eventually they come upon a boat, large ship, out in the desert. And they just keep going and going. And then they turn back and they notice there's smoke rising from the school. So they go back to the school, and you know, everyone, all the kids there are they're building a fire, and they're trying to basically call the rain. So they start singing a song about the rain, I believe, and actually it does start to rain, which is cool. But it rains everywhere, and it's like a downpour, I guess, and it starts to rain out in the desert. And it starts to turn the desert almost into like a quicksand, especially where Sho and his little group of explorers are. So Sho is kind of caught in one little area, and he allows the other kids to walk over his on his back as he lays there face down in the sand, so they can get across the one section of that's turned into quicksand. So they're like, "Sorry, Sho," stomp stomp across his back. So they manage to get through that. They eventually pull Sho out of that, and now as I think as Sho and the others are trying to head back to the school, one of of the other girls notices, well, some of the students, they notice a tsunami of water, and I guess like a mudslide coming towards the school. So a bunch of the girls, one of the girls goes to the front gate of the school and puts her back to the gate to try to help prevent the giant mudslide or flood that's coming towards the school. A bunch of other girls try to tell her, you know, stop, but then they end up joining her. And so there's about like 10 girls standing at the gate trying to hold it closed to prevent the flood coming in. And it's really strong, and they're doing their best, and the strength of the flood actually knocks off one of the girls' heads, and you see her head go flying. As they continue to hold on to the bars of the gate, one of the other girls' arms snaps off while her hands are still attached to the gate. It pushes, a couple other girls are pushed off, but they're still trying. And I think that's it for the gruesome death and any other kids getting maimed. So eventually the flood subsides, and all that's left is just the mud in front of the gate. So they actually did prevent it. They end up plugging the hole. So Sho and a bunch of other kids are coming back, they all find out that because of the rain, some of the flowers in the garden actually grew. I'm sorry, I misspoke there. There was already a garden, which they needed to help, you know, create oxygen, because there's really no other plants, on the planet. So because of, I guess Saki is the name of the girl, she helped, you know, they helped prevent the flood from destroying the plants. And then they kind of mention, and they talk about that, how they need the plants to breathe and everything. And that brings us to chapter 25, Sampling Future Plants. Alright, so now they're back in school, and it's getting dark, and they've devised a way to get the lights on by getting a bunch of pedaling a bunch of bicycles. So they do that, and they use their own, you know, power to muscles and everything to pedal the bikes in place and get electricity going, flowing. And now they notice some weird mushrooms growing on the various plants. A whole lot of mushrooms. They call them monster mushrooms. And so they're kind of, you know, trying to figure out what's going on. Are they any good? You know, can we eat them? And they find out they're just growing everywhere on all the different types of plants, even some of the other vegetables. And now there's a big argument going on about who should try the mushrooms first. And then the lunchroom man, Sakia, they figure they can try to get him to sample the mushrooms. So they lead him down to the garden, and he eats one of the mushrooms, and nothing happens to him. So they all think, well, they must be okay, you know, he ate them, so they must be safe. So then they try to make him eat another one, and he ends up spitting something out, and he's saying it hurts and all this, and all the kids are like, oh no, it's poisonous. Meanwhile, apparently they had a Sho tied up at some point, and now they're trying to figure out what to do with lunchroom teacher, because apparently he's sick, so they move him somewhere else. And then there's another kid that shows back up at the school who talks about monsters. It might have been the kid that they noticed who ran off of the school grounds in the very beginning into the desert and then fell over face first, or the kid whose footprints they'd recently found when they went out searching for water. Anyway, he comes back and he talks about, you know, he's seen monsters, and they kind of think he's crazy. Meanwhile, I forget where they put a crazy lunchroom man, but he ends up coming up onto a kid walking down the halls and forces this kid to eat a mushroom. And then he stomps the kid down onto the ground, puts his shoe, you know, right on the kid's side of his head. And he has a piece of broken glass, has a knife, and the kid on the ground is like, I don't understand, I thought the mushrooms were okay. And the crazy lunchroom teacher talks about how he just faked eating the mushroom and actually put it in his sleeve. He, you know, forces the kid at knife point, pretty much, just to, you know, wait until he eats and digests the mushroom. And I mean, now he thinks, you know, he's still alive, nothing's happening. Obviously, nothing is happening to him. Some other kids stumble upon lunchroom guy and the other kid, and it seems okay. And now they're all like, hey, the mushrooms are safe to eat. Sho still is, doesn't skeptical. And the other kids, a couple other kids start to eat the mushrooms anyway. Now one of these kids is running around telling everyone, we can eat the mushrooms, you know, we can eat the mushrooms, they're safe. And then one of the kids that ate the mushrooms is now talking about how they need to uproot all the other plants. And this one show picks up this one plant that was pulled out of the garden, and he's kind of like sad about it. You know, how could you uproot this poor plant? And meanwhile, one of the kids that the lunchroom teacher forced to eat the mushroom, he's just trying to tell everybody that, you know, these mushrooms will save us, we need to eat them. And they're talking about, they think they're like future mushrooms. And then Sho and some of the other kids start talking about how mushrooms don't generate oxygen and that need to be pulled up. And so they start pulling up the mushrooms, and the one kid who ate, was forced to eat the mushroom, starts running out into the desert. And meanwhile, they're back in class, and they find a statue, a bust of that Sho made out of plaster in honor of his mom. So they kind of use that as a way to pray to something, you know, while they eat and whatever. And then one of the other girls starts acting weird, who ate the mushrooms, and she faints. And then they find this other weird-looking sculpture statue that has one eye. And they're trying to figure out, you know, who did this, what does it mean? And then Sho ends up keeping watch over the statue, and I think someone comes in to relieve him, and then someone ends up knocking outside one of the door or the window, and the kid looks to see who it is, and as the foot steps through, it's all there's like two sharp claws coming out from the person's foot, and the toes are mangled. And that brings us to chapter 26, Cursed Cult. So the kids are freaking out, and you know, it's kind of dark, and there's this strange, almost monster-like thing coming through, and the kid spear and he stabs it. And they end up, you know, show and some other kids show up to help. And they struggle with it and they put a flashlight on it. And they ends up being one of the kids. I'm not sure if it was the one that ran away. But looking like that, kind of almost like a reptilian, you might say. So they're freaking out, and I think they come to the realization that he was one of the kids that ate one of the mushrooms, and now they're talking about what they need to do about that. They start examining everybody, and meanwhile they go outside looking for water, and they I think they end up finding a hole, or dig a hole, like a well, to see if there's any water at the bottom, because it is the place where a river used to be. And meanwhile, one of the other girls, I forget her name, Saki, maybe the girl that stood the first to stand at the front gate when the mudslide was coming, she notices a girl looking at herself by herself in a mirror. And she turns around, and her part of her face is turning into that, like, reptilian-looking, like the boy that I just showed you earlier. And then another kid who's completely, he's got fangs in place of teeth, and he's got lumps all over his face. His eyes even changed a little bit. He comes in after Saki. And then about six other kids show up, and they're all, they've all begun to change, like strange shaped heads. Their mouths have changed almost beak-like and frog-like. And so the one girl is kind of almost getting attacked by them, and she's able to run away. And then, meanwhile, this one girl, the girl that that was partly changing, talks about how that other statue with the one eye is their god. And, you know, the one girl that they're holding captive, Saki, I believe her name is, she's like, you know, what are you talking about? This is all crazy and everything. And she's trying to, you know, they're going back and forth. And then they're trying to bring her into the little cult. So they grab a claw off of an eagle, taxidermied eagle, that's in one of the biology classrooms or whatever. And they start to get ready to scratch Saki. Sho rushes in, and all the other kids run away. And then they, all these strange-looking kids that ate the mushrooms stumble upon a bunch of other kids. And meanwhile, that one girl who's trying to scratch Saki, she ends up leaping into the air at Sho, almost taking on a very frog-like appearance, reptilian-like, and she ends up jumping all around on all fours, attacking some of the kids. And they're like, you know, screaming out, you know, I mean, what's going on? What is this? Sho comes up to her and whacks her with a stick. She just chomps on it with her teeth and breaks it in half. And she's about to take a bite out of Sho's neck. And then all of a sudden, I think she snaps out of it at the sound of another student saying her name. And then this other kid, Otomo, who's somewhat at a rival of Sho, he wants to kill the girl. So she seems to be back to normal, but then she starts to scream again, this weird piercing shriek. But they have her kind of watching over her. Meanwhile, show and a bunch of kids go back out to the well to try to get some water. And meanwhile, they're back inside again with that girl that was leaping all around. And now she's in some kind of strange trance. And now all of a sudden, she becomes scared of something. And they're like, what's going on? She's like, something's, you know, it's coming or whatever. And so she's running. They're trying to, you know, figure out what's going on. So they're running out. I think they're running out after the bunch of the kids who ate the mushrooms. And they're I think it's them or just a bunch of kids. I forget. They might not even know. So Sho and a bunch of other kids are chasing these other kids. And they seem to just disappeared. And then they notice all these little footsteps in the sand coming after Sho and the other kids. So they run back to school. They close the door. They're all scared. They think it's invisible monsters. Meanwhile, the one girl who was leaping all around said, our God has come to kill us. And a bunch of other kids, they start getting on the bikes to get the lights back on. Some of them take up spears, and they're all just, you know, waiting, and that girl continues to shriek, no, it's coming, and they're waiting and waiting, and finally, in the main gate, at the main gate, I guess, where they're all gathered. I think they're inside, but outside, coming through the main gate, there's this one eye kind of thing coming through the sand. There's a whole bunch of sand up all around it, and it's dark, and you don't really see much except the one eye. And then all of a sudden, they're inside looking out the barred windows from one of the rooms, and the statue of that one-eyed thing from earlier is now outside of the school looking in. And it looks like some strange cyclops, bald cyclops with one giant eye and lots of ridges around its face. And that brings us to chapter 27, Giant Eye. So now there is this giant, grotesque creature with this one eye staring at them outside, and Sho is trying to tell everybody to stay calm, you know, hold your fire, let's see what it does. And you know, that one girl is still freaking out. The other kids, they can't take it anymore, so they rush at the window with their spears, smash the window, trying to, you know, attack the creature. And then there's all kind of crashing, all kinds of chaos going on. And all of a sudden, that girl, she snapped out of it. And that girl then turns to another girl and says, it's time to close your eyes, because I don't want you to see what's going to happen next. And then meanwhile, that one-eyed creature bursts through the door they had tried to lock and bar, and there it is. And I gotta say, I love just, you're gonna hear me say this through all the different mangas, commentary videos I'll be doing on this video, but I just love the, especially the mangaka for this particular title. How not only did he draw all the kids so they have their own unique look, but all the different creatures and monsters, from the centipede, crab, lobster, centipede, to this strange one-eyed frog, bug thing. That's great. So now that girl that was screeching and leaping all around, she says goodbye to one of the other girls, And she goes on all fours and leaves the school. And the other girl opens her eyes and thinking that she was taken. Her name was Yoshikawa. So now all the kids are, you know, trying to freak out. There's a new monster they have to worry about. And then meanwhile, lunchroom man shows up and he says, behold, it is I, Lord Sakia. So he's back. And that brings us to chapter 28, Cold Eye. So now the lunchroom teacher is back with this handmade spear gun. He's got some kind of steel arrow, looks like, pointed into it. He points it at the bust, that statue that Sho made of his mother, and pulls the trigger, and it shatters the statue. And Lord Sakia talks about how the arrows are poisoned. So now he's back trying to take, you know, charge and control all the kids, and Sho, you know, is trying to stand his ground and put up a fight. So there's some back and forth there. Sakia finds a kid who says that he saw Sho crawling into the ducts, or crawling underneath the school, and they found some old dynamite pipe, a fragment of handmade dynamite. So Lord Sakia tries to get the other students to brainwash them by blaming everything on Sho, that Sho showed up and tried to blow up the school with the dynamite. And of course, Sho denies it. And then all of a sudden, there's a school starts to rumble and shudder again. And Sho, I think Sakia got everyone to believe him and the other kid. So Sho's upset and he leaves. A bunch of other kids go down into the well. I think Lord Sakia is now forcing them to go into the well to find water. So Sho and a couple other kids are down at the bottom of the ladder. It's like a rope ladder. And then Lord Sakia pulls the ladder up. And, you know, he says, when you find something down there, he'll put the ladder back. So he comes back and he's Lord Sakia, the lunchroom man. He's trying to show all the other kids in the school that now he's in charge and everything. Meanwhile, Sho and a bunch of other kids are down at the bottom of the well, trying to figure out what they're going to do. And one of the other, you know, they're getting into an argument and getting upset. One of the other girls, again, I think the one that stood at the front of the gate first, she's digging away somewhere where they are. Eventually digs a hole, and they shine a flashlight into the hole and notice stairs leading down. And that brings us to chapter 29, I believe the final chapter for this omnibus, World of Darkness. So they go exploring down the stairs to see where it leads, going further and further in. All they have is the one flashlight. And then the final panels has a show saying the stairs ended in a wide space. Where are we? And they're just kind of looking out with the flashlight, and there's not much to show. They're just in an open kind of area with looks like walls and maybe a bench, something else, some kind of square container or something. And that is how it ends, with two to be continued. So that concludes book 2 of the series. Brings us to the final volume, final omnibus volume in the series, volume 3. So we pick up where we left off. We have Sho leaving a group of kids into this underground tunnel when they come across train tracks, specifically subway train tracks. So they realize they're in a subway and they keep walking, exploring further and further. They start to hear a rumbling sound. It gets louder and louder. And then they realize there is an actual subway coming right towards them. So they, you know, get off the tracks, back onto the platform. They begin to explore some more. They find another room, some pair of doors that are closed. They look into, it's like the basement of another building, and they open it up, and they see these strange creatures, monsters, which probably are what that one kid who returned back to school, remember he was, saying, you know, I saw monsters. So they're in the room with these, creatures, and they're very similar to the one that they saw attack the school, and the very same monster with the one big eye. It comes walking out, and they're actually talking, these monsters. And the other students who ate the mushrooms, they are there with the monsters. And those students are on all fours. So the one monster pulls back the shirt off of one of the hunched over kids to show how one of the kids is evolving into one of these monsters. So then the monster begins to show this old projector, and we go through this little section of the manga showing exactly what happened that led to the events of the future Earth, where the students are now. Basically, they're talking about the trash that humans created, how they found one of the very first forms of the monsters, and but then they kind of bury the creature. They kind of hide it and don't want to show the world their findings. And then it goes on into the humans have begun to use plastic to mimic their natural surroundings. And this is kind of being narrated by the monster. And eventually the rain and water begins to become scarce. Earthquakes and tsunamis are on the rise, and basically the Earth begins to become one giant desert, and that's pretty much what happens. Just lack of rain and for whatever reason. The one monster then points out our ancestor, the original future human, you might call it. And they have one of the monsters is nailed to a wall. It's by its arms, and you see its one eye. So it could have been that one early forms of creatures that were shown during that little slideshow, or one not long after that. So then their creatures are talking about the humans, and one of the other creatures was withholding some information, so the other monsters attack the one monster. And then the show and his friends are discovered by the monsters, and the one other girl who has become half monster tries to help and kind of becomes a distraction for show, and his friends, they can run away. So they're running away. So show and his friends are running away. They jump on board the ghost train. I think they do, at least. And eventually they find themselves at another subway station, when there's just dozens of bodies, corpses, all decayed and dried up from who knows how many centuries ago, on the subway platform. And they're all looking at them. They're all, the bodies are all mummified. So they're looking over the bodies to see if maybe their mothers or fathers are there, but they're not. So they find some money, but there's no date on it. And they keep looking. I see some footprints. Eventually leads to a door. They open up the door, and in the room they see a very old person eating one of the body parts, a leg of one of the corpses. So this other human they stumbled upon has to be, you know, 100 years old at least, if not more. Probably one of the last people on Earth to survive that wasn't teleported through time or anything. And then it just kind of screams at seeing them and dies of shock. So then they go back to exploring. They come upon there's a like an underground parking lot. There's a car. There's a large water pipe. And then they find a crack, a hole in the ground with water in it. So they're all, you know, excited they finally found water. But then all of a sudden the water starts to splash like a geyser. And it starts to heat up, and they realize the water then disappears, goes down the crack. They look further down the hole, and then they realize it's like a volcano underground. And then it starts to erupt, and there's lava coming out, and it's about to explode. So there's more and more steam, and I guess some lava shooting out of the hole in the ground. And they're all getting, you know, scared, and there's little fireballs, I guess, balls of hot lava being shot out of the underground volcano. So they're running away. They get to another area. They close the door. Run not far from where they were, and they're still trying to figure out, you know, what's going on, what could have caused the eruption. So they're getting into a little argument over that. Sho says he's going to try to ask his mom for help. The explosion, the eruption is getting stronger. They're trying to board, they're trying to block, seal up the door, so they'll try to, you know, be safe. So Sho thinks that the pipe is involved with the volcano somehow, so he's screaming, calling out, you know, mom, try to help them, or try to prevent them from installing the pipe. So he's trying to reach out to his mother again to get her to somehow help stop the pipe from being installed. And that brings us to chapter 31, Mom's Present. So Mom has, all this time, Mom has been writing letters to Sho and throwing them out into the ocean in the hopes that he might, you know, get them. And then she comes across some other person who notices this, I believe. And, you know, she's talking about, you know, kind of what's going on. That her son said the world is going to dry up. And then this guy mentions that they are trying to, Japan or Tokyo is trying to suck up all the water from deep underground, under the ocean. And there's a really cool panel here that I really like. Sho's mom is, you know, she's out on a dock somewhere on the Pacific, near the Pacific Ocean. And Tokyo, or the city, is behind her, and she points to it and says, "It's just concrete and asphalt as far as the eye can see. There aren't trees, rivers, or mountains. Soon after that, it'll really be a desert." And that speaks a little bit of truth. I mean, when you think about the cities, a lot of the sprawling cities have, where there's hardly any trees or grass left. And you kind of think about how that's like a little mini desert, because, you know, the cities have replaced all the trees and everything. So it makes a little bit of sense. So, and then she comes to discover there is a volcano not far from where they are. So she just gets upset, and she just says she'll write another letter. So meanwhile, they go back to the kids in the underground, and the volcano is getting worse. They're trying to keep the doors closed, and eventually the volcano erupts again. There's a large boom, and all this hot lava is now pouring out onto the subway platform, and it's coming through the doors that the kids were blocking, and it's getting worse. There's more of a shudder, like an underground earthquake, and that causes them to flee from the door, and they start heading up stairs, I think from where they came. And that takes us to chapter 32, Escape from the Darkness. So they're running up the stairs, trying to get away from the underground volcano and the apparent earthquake that's happening. And up ahead of them, as they're running out, the ceiling starts to crack and give way, and it blocks their exit. And they're still running. It starts to crumble. And you can just get a sense of how bad the eruption is. Things are, the violence of the, I guess, the quakes and everything, the tremors. There's a bunch of them, and Sho and a couple other kids are kind of behind the other group. And just at the last minute, a couple of the boulders or ceiling caves in and traps Sho. And I'm not sure if he's the only one trapped behind, but his quote nemesis, Omoto, I think his name is, I forget. This other kid that Sho gets into some heated debates with, or arguments with, confrontations. He's like, let's go, we can't save him. They even try to take his flashlight, take the flashlight from Sho, and things begin to really get worse. It's really, the ceiling is really beginning to cave in. There's more debris falling. The ground is starting to rumble even more. So they get up a little further, and they find out there's another cave-in, and they're trapped. So they're not sure what to do. And one of the kids says, this is what we get for abandoning Sho. So they're all trapped. And then Sho yells to them, cover your ears, cover your ears. And they're like, why? And one of the kids who was further away didn't hear. And all of a sudden you see this blast of rocks and air. And there was a change of sound pressure from the huge blast. One kid gets blasted up against a large sign, which is what is preventing their escape. He gets thrown up against it. And then the sign actually then falls down and crushes the kid. And then somehow the kids are able to help Sho out. After a lot of the rumbling subsided, Sho and Asamoto, I think, Otomo, that's his name, they get into another argument, pushing and shoving. actually tries to kill Sho, but then they stop. They eventually escape from the underground, and that's when they notice all those little invisible footprints that they thought was some invisible monster. Was actually all the little the monsters that they stumbled upon in the underground. It was little holes created by the monsters poking out their eyes above the sand. So they see this, and now all the monsters are starting to chase the kids back to school. And that brings us to chapter 33, Thread of Terror. So all these future humans, is what they're called, are chasing all the kids back, and the creatures are actually able to shoot like web-like material at the kids. Sho takes a shovel and goes back and tries to do something, fight back, and he damages one of the larger eyes on the creatures. And he says, you know, Sho yells back, their backs are their weak point. So he's all wrapped up in threads, and he's still trying to fight. A couple other kids are trying to help. But then one of the monsters grabs one of the kids, the shovels that the kid was about to use to hit the monster, and bites, starts chomping on the kid. Otomo, Sho's rival, now he's trying to help out and fight back. So while Otomo and Sho aren't the best of friends, they're not actually trying to, you know, put each other in harm's way. So they killed one of the monsters. So now they, you know, they gotta make their way back before the rest of the monsters try to kill them. They make it back, and they realize the other students put up a gate. And now the Sho and his friends are trapped between, they can't get back into the school, and the other monsters are coming. So Sho and his other friends, they're running along the outside of the school walls, and they get webbed up by the creatures. So the creatures have dealt with them. Now the creatures turn their focus onto the school. They climb over the walls. They can hear singing from inside the school. So the creatures, they're just shooting webs and climbing along the webs like spiders, getting closer to the school, the one building where the music is coming from. And the lunchroom man, he's forcing all the kids to sing as entertainment while he eats. So he's become like a little dictator. But that's what attracted all the monsters. So the monsters show up, and lunchroom man has appointed some of the students as commandos, commando one, commando two. So he orders them to fight the monsters. They try to, they end up getting killed or whatever. They're no match. Sho eventually breaks free of the webs. He tells everybody, you know, just step out of your clothes. And then he notices the lunchroom man driving away in a van. So Sho, you know, he notices this. He helps the other kids out of the webs, and now they're just in their underwear, and they start to chase after Mr. Sakia, lunchroom man, but he's kind of gotten far away from them. So Sho decides that they need to go back in and help the kids against the monsters. And at this point, Sho, he's crying, and he's basically pleading with the monsters. You know, he's saying, if you're really future humans, you know, you'll leave us alone, you'll understand. And then he basically faints, and he dreamed that he was a his tribe killed a mammoth, and then he was fishing in modern day, and how he caught a fish, but then he felt bad and put it back in the ocean. And then he had a dream he was back home with his mother. And then he eventually wakes up, and not really sure how much time passed, but the future humans left. Not really sure why, but maybe they finally listened. But the lunchroom man, he took all the food. And now there's a new threat. There's these weird, like four or five legged, like starfish crawling around the ground outside the school. And that brings us to chapter 34, Lost Friendship. So this new type of creature, I'll show you. You can see that there. So these new type of creatures, like future starfish, maybe, they just keep coming and coming, and they look out across the landscape, and they see tons of them coming, and they're trying to fight them off. They even manage to fight off one of these future starfish, grab one of its little appendages that was left that they hacked off. They take a bite of it. And it tastes gross, weird. They try to cook it. But then it was giving off a weird smell. And then they come to the realization that these creatures evolved, adapted to an environment that had lots of chemicals left over from previous world that humans lived in. So there is a little bit of a underlying political, environmental commentary going on here with the way that we, you know, with the pollution and trash and everything. So then there are just, you know, more arguments and discussions about, you know, between Sho and some other kids, and some of the kids are siding with Otomo, that's Sho's rival. Some of the other kids are siding with Sho. So they're kind of splitting up now again. And they're talking about food and supplies, and there's more fight, another fight between Sho and Otomo. Somehow the birds that the kids had, or the school had, on the roof. I'm not really sure why, but they break free and fly away. So more fighting between Sho and Otomo. Eventually they stop, and Sho, you know, I think they all split whatever was left of the food and supplies. So Sho and his little group, they decide to leave the school. And Sho has also started writing letters to his mom in a journal. So Sho goes to the other kids. Some of the other kids are talking about how this is their territory now. And they have the little kid, the toddler, with the tricycle. Sho goes and gets him. So now Sho and a couple other kids are trying to make their way out of the school. And the one genius, really smart kid, thinks that that there might have been an earthquake at the time when the school disappeared, which may have caused enough energy to send the school through time into the future. But he still needs to research it, he says. So Sho, and again, just more of Sho and a couple of kids trying to navigate their way through the school or out of the school. They keep getting these confrontations with some other kids who have spears. One gets killed. Sho didn't really mean to kill him, but then he thinks, well, maybe I did, because I did bring a spear. And then all of a sudden, Sho bends over in pain. And they're not really sure what's going on. He says, my stomach hurts. And one of the other girls says, maybe it's appendicitis. So now they're carrying Sho to a safe place. And meanwhile, Otomo has his own group of kids, and they marked off their own territory. Not really marked off their territory, but they've kind of made a certain section of one of the schools, one of the buildings. They've kind of made it their territory. So, this other group, Otomo, he's calling for Sho. They kind of, they hear all this moaning and everything, and they don't want Otomo and his gang to find out that it's Sho who's hurt. So this, the one girl, again, I forget her name, who, you know, was the first to stand up, put her back to the gate when the mudslide was coming. She goes and says that all the moaning is from a kid that they're kind of torturing, I guess. So she's kind of using that to tell Otomo and his group, you know, don't mess with us. So meanwhile, Sho, he's in pain. And that takes us back to chapter 35, Dangerous Surgery. So now they realize they need to take Sho's appendix out. And they actually do it. They find some alcohol to wash their hands. They find a little cutting knife. And they actually begin to cut open Sho, his stomach, vertically from the top of his ribs down toward his belly button without giving him any kind of anesthetic or anything. So it's really, there's blood splattering as they're making the incision. Sho has a rag in his mouth, you know, so I guess he doesn't, you know, swallow his tongue or, you know, whatever they have to do. So he bites down on that, and they're, you know, showing the cut, and it's, you can just imagine the pain. They keep going back to showing the surgery to Sho's face and how much pain he's in. I don't think he passes out, but he's just, you know, so much pain. And they open up the wound with their hands. You actually see, this is the first time you really see anything gory. So you actually see one of the kids opening up his stomach, showing the internal organs. And one of the kids who was doing the surgery says, you know, it needs to be wider. So they stretch his wound up even more. and he's just in total pain. And finally they can see the appendix. And they really need some kind of anesthetic or something. So the other kids, they try to go back to some flowers. They're growing some flowers that might produce something if they grind it up or whatever. But that's in Otomo's territory. So four girls run back to the garden to try to take some lilies, I believe. And they get confronted by Otomo and his group. They don't really explain what's going on. They manage to run away, try to escape. We flash back to Sho and his surgery, and they actually remove the appendix, and it's all like rotting. The appendix is still attached to Sho. There's I think it's actually one little part. I think the appendix is attached to something and it's one little part. I think they show that being cut off. I think they pulled out the organ that the appendix is attached to. It looks like intestines, but I'm not really sure. Anyway, I think they removed the appendix. Now they're trying to sew it back. Meanwhile, the other girls, let me flip back. Sho is also losing a lot of blood, so they want to do a transfusion. In the meantime, they're trying to figure out, you know, who has Sho's blood type. Then we switch back to the girls, who are trying to bring back a plant, which might help with Sho's surgery. They get into a fight with Otomo's group. One of the girls gets whacked in the back of the head. She throws the plant to one of the girls in the front. One of the other girls gets whacked. She hands off the plant to the main girl. So she's the last one with the plant. She runs back. She gets whacked. She stumbles down. But then a bunch of other girls show up from Sho's group. And they were able to push back Otomo and his group. They're able to help the girl, the last girl that survived. I think a couple other ones have survived too. Or I'm not sure now. I think the other girls, two of the other girls were killed. So they got the lily plant. There was a little bit of a cliffhanger there because they were like, we don't need the lily anymore. And the girl that's coming back with it is like, what do you mean? And because the operation was a success. So they're actually sewing Sho back up. And they found someone who has his blood type. So they begin to give him a transfusion. Eventually he wakes up. I believe it was 4 days past since he was out. And then we have a little scene of Nishi, the girl with the crutch. She helped out with the surgery. She ends up falling over. Looks like she's sitting down taking a break. But then it looks like she falls over, passed out or whatever. And then Sho, he's walking. It looks like he's walking down a street in present time, grasping at his stomach, in pain, screaming out, "Mom, it hurts!" Like he's having a fever dream. So then we flash back home to his mom. She's at home, and she has a walkie-talkie in case Sho can contact her. And then all of a sudden, Nishi is on the ground, the girl with the crutch. Sho is on the ground next to her. And Sho is laying there. They're both, their eyes closed. Sho is calling out in pain to his mom. And all of a sudden, his mom is talking through Nishi, but it's not Nishi's voice, it's Sho's mother's voice. Meanwhile, Sho's mom is like, "Sho, I know you can pull through this, you can make it," and all of that. And then Sho ends up, talking back to his mom or whatever. And then in present time, Sho's mom, father, the husband is there, and she says, "I heard Sho's voice again." So she's back out, running out down the street to try to help her do something, and she finds out they turned the school into a temporary garbage dump. People just started throwing their garbage into the school grounds. So she's upset over that. She goes to buy some groceries or whatever, and so she throws the groceries, some canned food, over the fence onto the school grounds. And then at the end of that, chapter, we have this old, looks like a creepy old person. Yeah, I'll show you. Right down the bottom there. Coming right up on the group that's gathered around Nishi and Sho. And that takes us to chapter 36, The Queen's Last Words. So we find out that that person is actually the queen from earlier, I believe in volume one, one of the older girls that tried to assert their dominance. So she's returned and she's screaming out, give me water. And that's when the kids realize she's the queen. And then just before she falls over and dies, she yells out something about paradise and Mount Fuji. So they're like, you know, what is she talking about, paradise and all this Mount Fuji? So the kids look outside, show he's recovered, he's back. And then they realize there's all kinds of strange creatures that have shown up. I'll show you that. See them there. And they're kind of getting concerned. Are they going to attack the school? And then they realize all the creatures are like fighting each other. And then another large, like worm, whale-like creature has somehow caused the smaller creatures, or has lured the smaller creatures into its mouth, and it eats all of them, including the future humans. It just swallowed them whole, and I think it just slithers away. So all the kids are kind of in shock at the size of the creature. And then they notice there's a dark cloud approaching. Some of the kids are thinking that that creature is going to attack them. And then one of the kids starts to think that now with all the monsters gone, that Otomo's group is going to come to attack them and take their food. And he thinks that they should go and get the drop on Otomo, attack them first. So Sho, he doesn't agree with that plan, but a couple kids decide to, you know, go and do it anyway. So I think they eventually do make it up, make it their way towards Otomo's group. They come across another kid. They end up killing him, but don't think they mean to. Meanwhile, these three or four kids, they decide to run away because they didn't want to get in trouble. They're watching those four kids run into the black cloud. Sho is there with that other girl. And they're like, you know, what happened? She's like, no. And that brings us to chapter 37, Death March. So the kids run into the black cloud. They come back, running back towards the school. And they're all, the kids that are running back are choking. So they figure that the cloud is not rain clouds, but a smog cloud. So Sho is trying to get everybody to, you know, we gotta leave the school, evacuate the school. And that's what they do. So they decide to take the queen's words and head towards Mount Fuji and whatever this paradise is they're talking about. So they make the trek. They come across a fissure in the ground, splitting the ground in two that they can't cross. So now they have they're up against this fissure in the ground and the smog that's coming up behind them. And they realize that they're going to have to jump across. So one of the kids decides to do it. He jumps, and he doesn't make it. His foot lands on the edge, on the other side of the fissure, and you see him falling down into the deep gully. So they try to find a place in the fissure where the two sides are pretty close, where the ledges are fairly close, that they can jump across, have a better chance of jumping across, and that's what they decide to do. So Otomo shows rival, nemesis, so to speak. He decides to make the jump first, and he makes it. So then they get all the little kids to jump across because the ledge starts to, the edge of the fissure, the cliff, starts to crumble. And the more it crumbles, the bigger the gap. And they know that the bigger kids, you know, they can jump last, knowing they'll have plenty of room to land. So that's what happens. All the little kids are able to jump across, including the toddler that doesn't even belong at that school. So they all jump, and the last, there's a couple kids that don't make it and fall. So there's no reservation by the author in showing more deaths as kids, girls and boys, that try to attempt to jump over. They don't make it and they fall into the chasm. So now it's just Sho and Nishi, the girl with the crutch. And he grabs her by the arms and swings her around and then launches her across. She makes it. There's three left. Nishi, and then another girl, and Sho. And they are the last two to make it across, and they do. So they keep walking, and then they find this structure. It looks like a flying saucer, half buried into the sand. So they walk into it, and they see a sign that says, Fuji Leisure Land Paradise. And they're like, paradise? And that takes us to chapter 38, Dangerous Paradise. So they come to find out that this paradise is some kind of amusement park. There's androids, humanoid androids still there, automatons that are talking and greeting them. And then the kids just, you know, they kind of think it's some kind of robot or something. They're kind of freaked out a little bit about it. This one automaton falls over, you know, the first one they come upon. It's, as it falls over, part of the flesh falls off, and it reveals it's half woman, half robot, and it starts walking after them. Comes up after one of the kids, and it's still trying to greet them, you know, please, this way, please, this way. It grabs one of the kids and actually crushes his head, and you see someone of his eye, one of his eyes bulge out, and there's a little bit of blood splatter. Now she's carrying the kid in her hands as she keeps saying, please, this way, please, this way. So she's chasing after them. They come to another section of this little amusement park. It's all dinosaurs. And meanwhile, that crazy robot lady starts messing with the controls, starts controlling the dinosaurs to go after the kids. The giant T-Rex comes down and actually chomps on one of the students and stomps on another one, which you see. So that's like, I don't know how many kids have been killed in this series so far, but it's gotta be like 20, you know, if not real close. I thought about doing like a tracking the number of child deaths in this video, keep it in a corner, but don't really have time for that. So anyway, they're trying to navigate through this little area, and there's more, you know, automaton robotic dinosaurs. The dinosaurs are now attacking each other. They come to another area where it's primitive, and there's a bunch of primitive type of people that are alerted to them. So they run away from there. They come into another area that's like ancient Japan, and there's like a shuriken that gets thrown at them. They escape from there. They eventually end up in the streets of what looks like modern time. But again, they're actually just inside this domed structure, which is kind of like a museum. So they find a candy store. I think it's candy, but they can't break the glass or get to it. And there's a Tomo and his group of kids. And they all get into a fight over the food in each other's backpacks. And the Sho and his little gang, they keep exploring, and they they find a hole in the wall to the little section of the present that they thought they got home, but they realize, come to find out, they're just there's no future world. It's all been destroyed, and you know, it's all kind of coming to the realization that they're in some kind of museum or whatever. Then they stumble upon a computer. The computer is still working, and computer starts talking to them, and saying, brilliant advances in technology will resolve all pollution. The earth will become a paradise. And like, what are you talking about and all this? And then the kids, tell the robot that that's not what happened. The world has been destroyed, and the computer's trying to, compute this. And then the computer ends up telling them that it's possible that some kind of massive energy spike could have, altered the events of the world. And then the computer ends up shutting down. Meanwhile, the other group that was getting into a fight comes in and takes one of the kids that I think was killed in the scuffle. And that takes us to chapter 39, Starving Group. So these other kids rush out where the computer is with this other kid, slam the door behind them. All the other kids that are with Sho, they're like, I'm starving, I'm hungry. What do we do now? So eventually they leave, and they see a fire, and we come to find out the other group that took the kid, I think that was dead, put him on a spit and barbecued him. And they cut off a piece of the kid's flesh, force it to one of the other kids to eat, and he eats it and swallows it. Right? No big deal, I guess. And all the other kids are like, yeah. So they pull down the kid that's been roasted. And they just start going after him like animals. And then they see Sho and his group. They're trying to run away. Actually, it was just Sho and one other kid. They were trying to see what was going on with the Tomo's group. A couple of kids from Atomo's group see them, attack them, kill one of the kids that was with Sho. Sho makes it back, but tells everyone they were roasting a pig, but they already ate it all. He didn't want to tell them that they roasted another student. That would just make everybody freak out. So now the two groups attack each other. They're still in this fake city, part of the Paradise Museum. The little toddler that's with Sho and his group, he starts crying. Saki, the one girl, kind of the bravest, somewhat leader of, I guess, all the other girls, she's crying. And then Otomo shows up, and he wants Saki to go with her. Sho is like, what are you talking about? He's like, you know, Saki doesn't belong with anyone. So they get in a little fight. Sho and Otomo, they're going at it. And just as Sho is on the ground and Otomo is about to shove his spear, stab Sho with his spear, Saki jumps on top of Sho to protect him. And then there's a big action flavor text. It says Chuck, C-H-U-K. It looks like the spear went through Saki. But they come to find out that Sho actually shoved the blunt end of his spear into Otomo. And just in time, as Otomo's spear just lands on the ground, pierces the ground next to Sho. So Otomo's on the ground. And Nishi is there, and all of a sudden, Sho's mom is talking again through Nishi. And they kind of find out that it seems like Nishi is psychic. And that gives Sho an idea. And that takes us to chapter 40. Confession of a Lie. So Sho is like, we have to go back to school. I have an idea on how I can help everyone. Otomo, he ends up confronting Sho one last time. Sho also kind of called out Otomo and his group for being like cannibals. They find a hand on the ground. And Otomo, you know, he's not going back to school. So he says, you know, I don't care. We're going to stay here, him and his group. And they he finds the hand, and he grabs the hand. One of the other kids grabs it and says, I call dibs. And Sho, in a means to get everybody back to school, admits that he did plant the dynamite. So now everybody's pissed off. And he's running back all the way through the through this paradise place. He grabs Nishi, Ray's back, and they, you know, they're all chasing after Sho to go back to school, and he's leading them back there. So eventually. He makes it back. They all catch up to him. They have Sho pinned up against a wall, getting ready to kill him. They're telling Otomo to kill him. And there's some back and forth about, you know, what Sho's plan is and how he lied about the dynamite just to get everybody mad at him to come back to school. And finally, Otomo admits that he was the one who really did plant the dynamite in the school because he was pissed off at the teachers or whatever. And finally, Sho and Otomo set aside their differences and kind of make up and shake hands. That brings us to chapter 41, Restored Friendship. So now that they're back, Sho believes that they can kind of wish themselves back home by getting all the students to hold hands and Otomo to, he realizes he has one stick of dynamite left. So they're going to light the dynamite while in this circle. And hopefully that's enough energy to send them all back home. Meanwhile, Mom is home, and she somehow gets the message that she needs to get everyone at home to wish Sho and all the students back. Somehow she manages to get on air on a show, on a broadcast, to do that. And all the people who are watching the broadcast, they're like, that's weird. Wish for those kids to come home. Should we try it? Meanwhile, back at school, the dynamite explodes. There's a big blast of air. It blows over the kids, dust and debris. But all the students are still there at the school. But now there's just a hole in the ground. And they're like, it didn't work. But then they see the tricycle from that toddler starts to disappear. And finally it does. But only the tricycle. So they're trying to figure out, why. Why just the tricycle? And in the distance, the volcano erupts. And there's another eruption close to the school as well. So there's more like earthquake, seismic type of activity. And they realize that the reason they didn't go back is because there's one other student who's not there. I think it was Saki or whoever. So we flash back to Sho's mom in the present. And all of a sudden, she's sitting at home, I believe, and all of a sudden there's a boom and a rattle at her front door. She goes to look, and the tricycle is right outside the front door. It's pretty cool. And so she's wondering, how could this get here? And meanwhile, they do this interview on this guy who broke into the school to steal the money. And how he, as he left to make his escape, the school disappeared. And it took part of his arm and part of his face. And then we have a scene, a panel here, showing half his face disappeared, his one eye, and I guess part of his brain disappeared with the school at the time he was escaping. But he can actually see out of that eye that's left behind. He can see the desert and everything around him. Meanwhile, his body is in present time during Sho's mom, her present. So most of his body is in real time. I mean, his one arm and part of his face is in future time. And part of his face missing reminds me of that scene from Breaking Bad with the Hispanic, drug dealer, the dark-skinned guy that ran the chicken, fast-food chicken restaurant. And his face was... half of it was blown off. Pretty gruesome. I'm kind of used to it, having watched horror movies and seeing so many different things, but being printed, published in the 70s, it's pretty gruesome for its time, especially in a medium like this. So now we are back to, future Earth, and that's that one girl, Saki, who's running away because she feels it was her fault that Sho and Otomo you know, we're fighting and everything. They end up, you know, she's about to run off the side of a cliff. But Otomo shows up and, you know, saves her. And they notice there's all of a sudden, a burst of water comes out of this fissure. And they're like, you know, surprised. And they say, you know, the volcano that erupted must have caused the water to come back. So now, you know, they have like a glimpse of hope. So they run back to school to tell everyone. And they come across another body that was out in the desert. I'm not sure if it was one of the students, but there's little sprouts growing out of the body. So they come back to tell everybody that there's water starting to flow again. There's plants that are starting to grow. So if they don't make it back, that there's hope. You know, all hope is not lost yet. Sho then says that maybe we can try to do it one more time before Nishi, the psychic girl, you know, uses up all her powers. So they form another circle. And just at that time, as they're going to try to, you know, send themselves back into the present when the volcano erupts again. And meanwhile, we see an adult's hand and part of their back and their shoulder in frame in this one scene as someone's watching the kids from behind a gate. And that brings us to chapter 42, Drifting's End. So Lunchroom Man is back, Mr. Sakia, I believe, and he wants them to fail. He's lost it. He says this is the age of ruin. So all the kids are laying there. The volcano erupts again. But they're still there. It's not working. And the psychic girl, she's laying there. She's waking back up. And Sho says, you know, we can't, you know, go back home. It's just not going to work. And he decides to change perspective and say, you know, we've been chosen. We've been sent here to take care of this world and to make it a better place. So, you know, as they're, you know, they're talking about, you know, look, the plants are growing. There's water. All of a sudden, the birds start to show up. And then a rocket comes out of the sky and lands, and the door opens, and they approach the craft, thinking it's from a spaceship or something. They see a note from Sho's mom, and she basically collected all kinds of food and supplies and whatever, and was able to send a rocket. Somehow they managed to send a rocket from the present, and it ended up in future time. And everything they have now, they basically have everything now they need to survive. But meanwhile, the little toddler, he's, you know, crying and scared, and, you know, he wants to go home. You know, they're like, no, we can't, you know, we're trapped here. Meanwhile, they go back to rush back, and maybe they have one chance just to send. You know, they all can't go back. Maybe they can still send a little toddler back. So Nishi, psychic girl, she's still asleep. So they all gather together to try to send the little kid back. And that's when a crazy lunchroom guy shows up again. And he says, you know, move it, Pipsqueak. Yeah, you're not going home. I am. And at that point, the criminal that robbed the school of their paychecks, half of his face and his one arm launches out of the toddler's backpack, which is like, it's comical, yet horrific and disturbing all in one. And his hand, his arm, actually launches itself off the ground to attack and gouge the eyes of the lunchroom teacher. And it's actually scratching at his face and everything. And so the teacher is having a fight with the criminal's arm from the past. And it reminds me of the scene from Evil Dead 2 with Ash when he cut off his hand. So the hand actually starts choking the teacher, and I think it eventually kills him, chokes him to death on the ground. So all the kids get back together, form a circle. There's another volcanic eruption. Meanwhile, back in the present time, the criminal gets half his face and his arm back. And the mom is at home, and all of a sudden, she hears something at the front door, and it's the toddler. He's there with a journal. So she's like, he kind of explains to the mama he's a friend of Joe's and all that, and he came back by himself, and he gives Joe's mom Joe's notebook. And the kid, you know, goes back home, and there's a few pages of that kid, you know, being brave as he goes back home. And meanwhile, we go back to scenes of Sho's mom. She's holding the journal. She's sobbing and crying as she reads some of the words from Sho's journal. And then she ends up somehow getting a hold of a scientist, talking to him. He was able to somehow get a hold of the letters that she was sending. Throwing into the sea. So I believe that the scientist is the one who probably eventually sends the rocket into space with the hopes of it getting to future Earth and all the students. And then the series ends with her envisioning Sho and all the other students happy and gleefully gambling across the night sky. And she's there at the, just looking out into the night with her husband who's there. And we end by saying, time passed, still Amiko hoped, Sho's mom, there would come a day when cheerful laughter would connect the present and future. May Sho's mother, all mothers, and all of you be blessed with an abundance of joy. And that's how it ends. So the kids, you know, they don't make it back except for the toddler. Man, that was cool. They send him back in time. And everyone, I guess, eventually comes to know that the kids made it. Unless the mom just keeps it to herself. You know, who really knows? Given the fact that there was a memorial and everything. So, thank you very much for, again, for tuning in and for watching or for listening, if you've even made it this far. I think this video is like 3 hours long. I really only hoped that it would be 1 hour. But here we are. I'm gonna, in future cases, when I go to do a commentary on the other manga series, I'm gonna have to try to figure out how to save some time. So, great book, great series, some political undertones, which I think were fine. It wasn't like constant in your face. Great illustrations, a lot of stuff about friendship, struggles, you know, and all of, I mean, it really had a lot. It really covered a lot of different real life stuff. And this is what I like about manga. It's not just like, it's deep. They talk about death. They talk about love and friendships, and they talk about daily stuff like eating food. And so it's, this is why I like manga a little bit more than comic books. And even, I don't really have the patience to read regular books. I just love the art when it comes to manga. But, you know, when it comes to the mangaka, the people, the authors, you know, they have freedom. They're not afraid to discuss and portray all kinds of different, you know, scenes and aspects of life, especially when it comes to death, compared to here in the United States, where it's almost like we shouldn't even ever talk about death, let alone show it in any kind of medium, you know. So, not that I condone or I'm trying to promote that we should see more death and more kids getting killed, but I'm just saying it's a part of life. It's just a book, after all. It's just an illustration, just somebody's idea. I think there's just a mentality out there, you know, when it comes to people's view of make-believe, and that, you know, we shouldn't ever show certain things or whatever. I don't know. I don't want to get into a big thing. So, great stuff. Loved it. You know, can't recommend it highly enough. And I think that'll do it. So, again, thanks for tuning in, for watching. Whether you are into manga yourself, this particular title, or maybe you don't, hope you still found this video to be enjoyable. And stay tuned, probably, you know, 2 months' time, when I'll be showcasing another manga title, and hopefully it won't be as long of a video. Figure out how to shorten it a little bit. Alright, so until next time, take care of yourself. I wish you all my best, and I hope to see you in another video real soon. So long for now.